super. Warmly welcome to this panel we are talking about today about but before we go to the discussion of the business, I also like to mention that the Holy Council Minister's Office in Estonia is celebrating this year the 30th anniversary. So it's actually joined in the office in Estonia, the same year when Estonia regained its independence. And we have been in close cooperation ever since then. The way we have cooperated has changed during the years, but I would say that the results have always been really good. And this year we have three panels today here, and at 7 o'clock we also have a movie screening in the five right now, I would like to welcome all of you on site and online, since we are also streaming this show. So, we have a lot of online as well. And we have today really knowledgeable and wonderful panelists. And I start to introduce to my she served as the 11th president of Finland and was the first woman to hold that position from 2000 to 2003. She was a member of the parliament for more than 1979 until her election to the presidency. She also served as a minister many times for many years, for example, Minister of Social Affairs and Health, Minister of Justice, and Minister for Foreign Affairs and Health. I'm working for the Holy Council of Ministers. I'm also glad to say that she also worked for a couple of years as Minister for Nordic Cooperation. And I would also add that she was a very, very popular president. Her approval ratings at the peak in December 2003 was 88%. It was my surprise that she was not re-elected in 2006. But she's also widely known for her interest in human rights issues. And she has served as the chairperson of the Finnish LGBT rights organization. Actively participated in the discussion of issues such as women's rights and problems of globalization in the presidency. So I could say I could continue for long, but to put it briefly, I would say that she has changed Finland, and she has also changed the world. And currently, she is also the headlines in Estonia because of a book. Not translated to English, but I would translate it to a tale about an activist. But this book is now published in Estonia with the name Activist Mobile, and it is written by Pax America and translated by Andros. And there's also a big possibility here to buy a book there if you are interested. So, President Arvamusfestivalil, it's a pleasure to have you here. And we have agreed that usually when we have this Nordic discussion, we only use the first name. So, Tarja, what do you think? Then we have Kristina Kallas. the head of Estonia 200 political party, former director of Narva College, and always been a really, really good cooperation with us and always know something about this person, you don't know something about this institution. You have to come back and get to the right thing, and you're aware of it, you have heard something about it. And if you say just don't call it this, then you're a particular person, and that means that you already know something about this person or this institution. What might your wife face that morning? That was something else. That was how much you trust the person that you haven't met before. That is true general trust. It's not that social trust. If you see the person that you have no previous knowledge about, if you see a good person, if you see a trustworthy person, that's not something about how you view the morality in the society that you're in. So, how do you think my wife reacted that morning when she gave me a letter, something in your life? Yes, she did. And would you have done it? I don't know if you raise your hand, but just think about it if you would have done it. The funniest thing about the story is that you never encountered one of them, because it was scary. I usually tell this story because it's important to understand the social trust. The concept of social trust is how you view the morality of the society that you're in. It doesn't necessarily have to be like that. It's your perception. But it's good in a society that has people like my wife, for reference, it's one treasure. Trust is one thing because it has been proven by researchers over and over that this having rather high level of general trust or social trust in society benefits, first of all, the economy. It benefits in the way that your work will never be in the society very high levels of trust or social trust. You will need less lending, police officers less lending, lawyers less lending, security guards and so on, but that they are sort of to do something bad. Those resources could be used for other things. Instead, that is sort of more competitive. And it's not marginal. The researchers have pointed out if you manage to increase social trust in society by 10%, GDP is going to take around 0.3% or 5% points. So indeed, it's not something small, it's something that depends on language. But it's not probably good for the economy, it's mostly good for society. Society should have high levels of trust and can function better. Generally, lower levels of crime in our society. People are more inclined to pay their taxes, and it usually strengthens democracy and the democratic institutions. But still, it's also good for individuals. People tend to be happier when they're in this kind of society, and they also feel that they have control of their lives. So I would say that almost all of us would prefer to live in a society with high levels of social trust. The local countries are in part where you measure these things. To see the positive effects that you get from social trust, that's why it's important for you to know that we need so much of a democratic society. That the small parenthesis that the still is actually also quite high in social trust levels. So I would stop there. I would just say there are two mechanisms that sort of divides how they get to social trust. That is how the state functions and civil society.
Thank you,
Funny, when I was listening to your story, sorry, talk about something, it's not too much that I could say. Because something is the way I have had in the newspapers, the way I have had in the summer, similar stories, because it seems that I'm trying to get money. If somebody asks me, but I don't have money for the ticket to go to my bus back to my home and so on. But then we have had now these stories that also people use this nowadays. And I'm sorry to say, but sometimes the people who have not been to or from the members of the society. And so I thought to start from the different perspective. I think that when we have tried to find out how to create the security and confidence and trust between the people, so we always come back to the tribal. And we say that the first step for the trust When you have lost your trust with your ones or your close ones, so you can learn it again, but it's much more difficult than doing. And then when we come to the difficulties in the society, so of course the especially difficult challenge is the person who has never found somebody to trust or talk to you often. And now, So, thank you. you do, the same message to that very person, which is the general system.
Thank you. I think that you are in a different world.
I'm not an expert in first of all, I have to build up a little bit to know what to look at this smart government topic because my research is in a different field. But I understand that as a politician, I do have the privilege of not having opinion on the things that I have to discuss opinions here. When I was listening to Ulf and Maria's presentation of short introductions, I started thinking that honestly, most of the successes and happiness and welfare of the Western liberal democracy is based on trust. Because the democratic system only works if there is trust. This is my dog. He doesn't agree with me. Democratic systems are based on the trust. Welfare system is based on trust. If I don't trust system and other fellow citizens, I'm not going to pay taxes on you, can't pay my husband. So it's also based on the cost. And sometimes I wonder whether the Nordic countries, welfare states, are so successful because there is a trust basis under them that it helps to run the system. Because if we look at other countries that have been trying to establish similar welfare states, but have failed several times, it's just because of the lack of trust. There's no trust people who don't end up paying taxes. Then I came with my thoughts to Ukraine because I've been working in this country recently a lot. And then I started realizing what is the difference between political trust and social trust. I guess you want to talk about trust towards the state and trust among citizens and civil society. Because what I noticed in Ukraine in 2014 when I went to extensively when another revolution was happening, which was very on the ground, I noticed that there was a strong trust among citizens and civil society. Organized, they trust each other on that level very much. And there is a complete lack of political trust when it comes to the same people actually trusting the leaders they elect. And every time that each revolution in Ukraine fails next time, just because of the lack of this political trust, people just don't trust the institutions, they don't trust the politicians they elect. No matter how many times you actually enact and use the social trust to make a change in your society, make the society stronger or give the democracy every time you fail when your political trust is failing. And I think that's the move on Ukraine that started me thinking that social trust necessarily is not in the area of political trust. That there's no causal connection there. That some countries have both of them strong and successful, and some countries have one element there, but the other element is not there. And in case of Estonia, coming to my country, indeed, what is surprising comparative to other post-Soviet countries, I think Soviet system, the totalitarian Soviet system, was something that was consistently destroying social trust. I mean, it was a system that needed individualized individuals who were afraid of power, scared, hiding, could not trust the neighbor because what the neighbor was telling on you, the Soviet system was a trust-breaking system among the humans. And yet, my country has managed to, I don't know whether this is to retain or to rebuild quickly the social trust. And I agree that the research shows that Estonia has high social trust levels, and also not that bad in terms of political trust. So that led me to question maybe what are the causes of the differences in societies that either gain or regain social trust, or completely lose it and not successful in regaining it or building it.
Yes, I would like to ask if you would like to add anything, and perhaps also give you a clue of what the cornerstone for such a
thank you for the
with opening your books every morning and having a little bit of an assistant to listen to, I completely agree with basically all of what you've said so far. Trust is a certain kind of thing. Trust is very important when it comes down to how the society works. I mean, boils down to every day of it boils down to what they need, how we operate as institutions or organizations, but it boils down to how people interact with each other. One thing that we've experienced in many of the non technical contexts is that when we look at how civil society the partnership for the past 2 years, we've been working on strategic partnership between NGOs and ministers. One thing that has changed over the past couple of years when we've been working with your country ministry, which goes from the Ministry of Social Affairs, when we ask organizations, what's your attitude or what's your relation, how do you see the ministry as your partners? Do you see them as partners, or do you see them as owners or controllers, or how do you actually see them? And one thing that has changed over the past couple of years in the answers have boiled down to why the trust has increased in some instances. It's because the person representing the ministry. So if the organization sees that the person who represents the ministry, the civil servant, or the public official, for that matter, if that person is, let's put it very easily, if that person is nice, treats the other organization representatives fairly, sort of respectfully, then we see that the relation and trust increases between the two organizations. If that person representing the ministry is focused on controlling, is focused on your NGO and your society is to provide us, or your role is to provide us for certain services, or somehow sees as, you're an NGO, you're going to steal our money anyway, whatever you want to do. So it boils down to the person representing the organization, how they actually interact. So if you ask what's the cornerstone of trust and what's the cornerstone of how trust operates in the society, then from our work, I think that it's every single person. How we actually, what's our attitude towards each other if we, and that applies to ourselves as people on a social level. It applies to us as our work representatives of institutions, our sort of official role for that matter. And I think both can be implemented in the sense that we can build that trust. But it needs to start from that personal level, really trusting my fellow, really trusting my fellow, not wanting to harm me personally. Even if we disagree, we have to sort of come and go or something that unites us, something that brings us together, we can actually work together for a good thing.
You see that I've got something to say, trust, but before we go into that, I think I would like to follow up on what Kelly said, who is really responsible for us
they are more and more difficult. So, and then of course we have soldiers. What is to do? And then of course we have proud to build society such that they are not so easy. the funds we've got to spend well, that we can help build the priority. And so, I think so that my experience is that it's very important that this rank and file level just can be built. And then we have to be very open-eyed and ears for that, that we kind of the group of the people are already receiving this trust. Sometimes it's very difficult to accept that they have got this. For instance, my sweet brother who can say this, or the very strong religious organizations, because at the same time when they have given in the center kind of the security and the safety of the trust, so it can be also a lot of limitations and some people can consider that it's very unfair. But if you have to start, you have to find that what the people themselves, if they have something to trust, is why they trust and can we use that. And that's why, for instance, nowadays, in the United Nations, we have also the religious organizations in the whole of the the vice way is critical that no system as such is without mistakes. And this is the question. But this is of course not the amount that helps. The fact is always very active on the NGO side. And my mother and my father, they all have been also unionists. They have been great for the trade union, the union movement. Always, if I say one Christian, it's not so easy to be here in Estonia. And so, all such kind of things which are very strongly tied to the security. And so, I think that critical participation is the same that for each and every one of these issues. But the main one is that they do it, if they don't do it immediately, then they start from one issue. And so, I think that this can be the singing in the house, so maybe it can be the sexual abuse, it can be the feminist, it can be the dress, eating,
whatever. Yeah, I can't but agree, but still, we need a role model, of course. The man who can play like the female as a politician.
You can be the role model.
I will. I hope that I am. But you see, I mean, as a politician, I mean, you have a really responsibility after all. I mean, even though we all know how responsibility is, but still,
I'm not saying we're in Parliament yet, but I feel the responsibility. I think you are hinting to the fact that what kind of role model politicians should be, and nowadays we see too many politicians who are not role models of doing the trust. And unfortunately, that's probably right in the sense that doing politics has changed, and the element that has become very visible in politics is this strategy of mobilizing your own voters in a very narrow segment of your voters, and you know that you are not going to ever reach to the other voters, so there is not anymore the strategy of trying to gain as many votes from the whole population. That means that you have to be actually welcoming and building some kind of a coalition. If you are rather just sticking to your voter base, and then you are antagonizing the other voter base, and this is doing the freedom kind of this conflict in the political field, and that's happening very a lot, and it's more and more, and I think with the rise of populism, I think even becoming kind of a success story, because populists are gaining political support as a result of this kind of strategies of creating privileges in societies. And because it's giving them popular support, they actually keep doing it, and sometimes some other parties are trying to follow because it gives you success. So why wouldn't you try? It's successful. But what is the impact on the social trust or in political trust? I think that's not on the agenda of some of the politicians, for sure. We can see that. So in old times, when you were
the leader of the political party and you had a meeting speaking to the audience, you didn't know who your audience was because you could watch the population out there, but you didn't know them. Because you didn't invite them from the Facebook to your little bubble, you know. You actually, all kinds of people came and you had to address them all in a speaking way that they all would trust you. Nowadays, it's different. You invite people, you organize a meeting, you only invite your own supporters, and then you talk to them, and you talk in a very kind of antagonizing way to other people who are not at the meeting. And this is something that, unfortunately, social media has helped us to organize such things.
Yes, I think that's a very important point. And we would like to, because we have a lot of transparency, and we would like to keep some when you think about the generations, I think that they
I think 10, 15 years, we have at least one example in this danger where you have a person going from community to community, putting together locals, not as a political party, not as a person with any political aim, but just as a very important topic in heart, and getting people to actually listen. How good is it? It's another discussion, how you position in this global society. But we see that there is at least, if a person goes and determinedly works on a local level, talking to people, random people, people in rural communities, it is possible to actually get them together. It's possible to hear their thoughts and one reason to, or one option, or one way to actually build trust. If you allow people to share their fears, share their thoughts, their challenges that they face every day, you can actually, going to support them. At least, I know that system is better than my own friends, so the has been very efficient at doing that. Has connected many supporters all over Australian local communities. I think the reason that has been successful is that they've gone to the people. They actually built up this sort of infrastructure or this, I go to you, I listen to you, you as a person, as an individual, and I don't know, whichever village, you are important. You're important enough that I come to you, I listen to you, I hear you, I haven't seen other political parties do as effectively as they can do it.
They're not political parties, so I understand the strategy. It's just that if you look from a political party perspective, it's much faster and easier to get the votes the other way. So since they don't need votes, they just need to, people to change people's minds. Politicians nowadays don't need to change people's minds, they need just to get votes. And that's the story, which means that it used to be much harder to gain the votes. You had to also get the hearts and minds of people to get the votes. Nowadays works much easier through the technology, through the social networks, much easier, much faster. So by provoking, by stirring the emotions of people through social media, that works much faster. So in this sense, I'm not saying that it should be like this, but maybe the position should work like this organization, and depending on what it's doing.
Is it also easier to lose trust in the political practice?
Well, it's easier to get both.
I agree. Perhaps it's also easier to get both.
Yes, and you can see this political practice are gaining support and then they're losing the support. And that's especially happening with public speech, because the support is not based on any kind of winning the hearts and minds, it's based on the moment of emotions, during the moment of emotions, and people behaving based on emotional status.
Now we have about the variety of the new governments, so before we do, I would like to give the audience the opportunity also to put forward questions in case you have any. We have a microphone. And please, when you
It was the first time when abortion was forbidden, and was one of those activists who tried to stop it, and we didn't make a success, and it just continued in the same way, as much as I respect the values and the others. This time for the people, or the freedom of the people, was paid by the freedom of the women. And so, today, people think that it has happened since the trend which then continued. The interesting question is that how to stop it, how to change it. If I take an example of my own country, Finland is in many, many ways considered to be a very good place for so forth. We still have a standard of violence. And we think that it's because of our past that is pretty violent. Thanks for our interesting neighbors, that was not the only one member. You could be a role model, you could be a role model, and so I mean that in a way that people can grow as a middle school that
fix, you know, and people would make, not to think that they had any relations with one another, but to marry them. And then all that happened with the so-called citizens then, sometimes politicians have to do because of the election system, because they want to continue to be the government, which is not totally insane. It's taking something that they want to do this year. And so, it's kind of the election system stops the way to do the progress in the national and to make a sense of it. And so that's really the idea of the institution. Why? Because at the same time, people might think already. Thank you.
Okay, but then let's move on to when I already had to see the time was about to blend into the command trust that you
Yes, this is related to, or the result of this internet time is what you've mentioned, that in order to have trust, you have to have good policy, but also the society has to be cohesive, which means pretty much that there is shared cultural space and shared information space and shared values. So this is how it works. Okay, in other words, we can also say that it's some kind of a good nationalism at work. People are feeling belonging to the same nation, they are sharing the same values, so in this sense, nationalism is also by the good story, not only the bad side of the story that we know where we are. So nationalism works in a good way by creating a cohesive society, building trust among people, and then we are entering into the technological internet world where this cohesiveness is not anymore controlled by the hegemonic state, it's actually coming from all the corners of the world. And the state that used to be the centerpiece of the monopoly of power and control, you control what you study, what you can read, what kind of news you get, that was all under the control of the state. It was much easier to build a cohesive society. Nowadays, it's not the case anymore. And so it's much more complicated because people are getting information from outside of the state. And I'm not implying here that there's some kind of enemy who is interested in making your people getting fake news. Not only that, there's also random information wandering in internet space that people are putting to their Facebook, for example. But if you think about nowadays wars, or what we call a hybrid wars, that are also mostly going on information space. This is what is the main goal of your potential enemy who wants to wage a war against you? It's not that much of something anymore. It's using the information and using access to your people to destroy the trust inside of your society. This is how the modern war looks like. So that's how they are operating to make you not believe into your government or to make you into conflict with your fellow citizens, whether this is under immigration, or whether this is about same-sex marriage, or many other issues that are potentially conflictual inside of the society, forces from outside are capable of using this conflict to destabilize the situation by breaking the trust among the people and breaking the trust between people and governments. And I don't have a solution how to deal with it.
But I think it's more often that these kinds of patterns of nowadays war are harder to these kinds of tools to work if we have a cohesive society. If we have already managed to build a society where people trust each other, where our institutional trust is high, then it's harder to actually beat these outliers to have any kind of impact. Come to get that trust. If we look at the statistically for the last 20 years, trust in institutions has increased. For example, police. And as we sounded with individuals as well,
in this day where people can tend to trust police. Quite highly. That means that we don't think these men are props, we don't think they're somehow out to get us or whatever. But at the same time, more than cost or petty crimes or misdemeanors, we often get to police. So we do trust police, yes, but at the same time, we don't think that it's worthy or we don't even bother to report when we are actually at the time. The same, I think, applies to women against violence and violence against women. These cases, rape cases, they very often do not get reported because they don't trust that they will be dealt in a sort of correct way, to say that. So we see again that all of these items are intertwined. So if we want to build trust in society, we do need to build it and put them up and help them as well, because it's so intertwined in every level and every aspect in society. So we do need to build institutions that talk to people in an understandable way. Just we need to have policy that actually people understand. And another fact that we have been seeing this sort of initiative called upon we want the public officials, policy makers to actually talk to people in a simple, clear, understandable language. So the interaction between class and institutions can be understood. For civil society, before we actually started this discussion, we already got to talking with all the experts. One thing that we've been doing for the past 20 years, or even longer. I became a debater and a member of the Sermon Debating Society, I think 17 years ago now. I remember this sort of movement, grassroots, very sort of energetic organization where we had massive amounts of volunteers, everyone who wanted to do something, you had to continue to have to, so get your hands dirty, so to speak. Nowadays, a Sermon Debating Society is a very professional, very good organization. And it kind of feels that it's providing service to these youth participating in these events and whatnot nowadays. So we see that they are becoming more professionalized, they're becoming more efficient. But that means that the participation and by a sort of personal approach or a personal sort of ability to actually change your ability to have a say in organizational democracy or organizational decision making process is valid. So we don't see this sort of civil society as a movement. We see more and more professional organizations providing services. But we do need to go back to that previous way of actually pulling our people together and giving them a chance to be united and giving them a chance to actually implement change and be part of something.
Thank you. The role of media is to stop the conversation. The second thing I want to say is, speaking about Estonia, what one could imagine is that when big data rights of social class become incorporated into the debates, because it becomes richer, it doesn't necessarily have to be that way. It doesn't mean that the increase may become richer and richer. But social class in the US is a
interesting, and I'm also very, very interested in media all the time, because being a politician, of course, you have been more of the driving for the goal for the media to do with these politicians. And then now I've been for quite many years working with one of the big media organizations, and I'm working very closely on my and I know how difficult it is to make and to deliver on the news. For instance, because in USA, presidential elections and so on, because nowadays both the text and voice and the photos can be either part of the real one or the fake one. So then the role of the media of the Western there has been no money to be a watchdog for the politicians. And sometimes they are so successful that they really they see the problems and crimes and so on. But how to create, it's much more difficult to media to create a trust, a confidence, than to say that I'm going to do that. And they so well. So this is really a media program. Sometimes I say that, yeah, it can be so that we have the mainstream media, but they don't do nothing. Because those societies, they are known especially in the West. Because of course it is always the freedom and the speech and the topics. And that should also media remember that we all can have a sort of kind of opinions, but we would need these when we have been creating the sustainable development agenda, so of course we try to find the ways how to measure that which kind of development is happening. And so it's also a very, very big issue to create the system of the company. And of course, that's in the story that we also, but it's also very they are very careful to do this, because people who want to do this. They don't only to do it for yourself, because some of us who have been experienced, we are pretty hard to attack. But then they do it for the family members, the friends, some of the accountants, what you want to protect. I really think that international corporations which own this system, they should by themselves to be more active to do it. A certain kind of news in this media world. I see a bit of optimism that can happen because it's also into the old business of whether it can grow in the way that it's possible to money. But yeah, I think that why people say that I don't know. I can say from my own experience that, for instance, I'm in my children. Thank you. I don't think you understand, even though the children move abroad, because they don't have to be able to come. And it's a very, very big thing that
think you have the
I worked for a couple of years at the European Union. My name is Kirsten Magnet, and I worked for a couple of years at the European Center of Experts for Country and Sex and Peace, and reflecting what Kirsten and I were saying, but also what you were saying, Madam President, just prior to this. My intervention there, that is about the structures that withhold resilience in a society and in the state, which means that actually, I think this is something that has not been reflected enough in society, so perhaps also you could elaborate. But how does the trust and the civil society, democratic institutions, human rights, freedom of speech, how does that build security or deteriorate or eat up security of your state and of your statehood, which is not the same thing? And what Madam President, you said that also the research recently made by the platform, the director of this particularly female politicians that are hit by hate speech and which is scaring them off. And this is in very, very great contradiction with what you said earlier, what you all have said earlier, bringing multifaceted base for political debate and in particular to bring women into the political debate and decision-making positions. He's actually promoting both resilience and security and the national positive basis of democracy with uses in any society. So resilience is a security and trust as a basis of
I think that we have something to do with the ideas of the clean of the state and the society in a way that we have spoken about the corruption. So, of course, that corruption itself is a very bad way to make it. But I'm trying to
system. And so I think that why did they use the money? And the person has the right to farm corruption. in some point technically defined, so ethnicity matters here, and that's the one problem that is at my heart, close to my heart, because I think we are weak because we have a ethnic, not a division lines, but grievances on the ethnic basis of Australia, and that makes us weaker, and that also undermines our trust. When we see that Russian young people get less better jobs than Australians, it's not the discrimination, it's the fact that the Australians were usually the ones who did the jobs, don't trust them, because they look like strangers, they don't hear the jokes, and they don't understand my jokes, and they feel like immigrants who speak Australian way, but not other people. So there's a lack of full trust there, and that's why there's inequalities, and inequalities is something that is easy to fix.
This is something that I mean, maybe this is the one for our assemblies and we have to discuss about this, but now we only have to find, but I think that it has been really wonderful discussion. Thanks to our knowledgeable great analysts, let's say that you have been thanked. Big thanks also to our audience here on the site and our